لك مقصودي ومعتمدي.
الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، صلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وفقهنا إذا جهلنا وزدنا علما نافعا وعملا متقبلا يا كريم. وبعد، in our last session we're speaking about choosing a partner, choosing a partner for marriage. We mentioned the four qualities that the Prophet ﷺ spoke about, but how he emphasized religion as being the most important, as well as character. Religion and character as being the most important qualities, but at the same time not negating the other qualities that we spoke about. Then we also looked at, or we had a brief discussion about the ways in which a person finds somebody to marry. What we want to discuss particularly here before we move on to proposal and engagement and pre-marriage, what happens there, is the role of the parents within marriage. The role of the parents within marriage, which is a key issue in a negative and in a positive sense. In a positive sense, the ideal for a person, the ideal situation is that the father, and here the discussion is really around the father, is that he's central in terms of helping, and the mother is central in terms of helping a person to get married, to find a partner. The parents are central in that. They have an important role within that. Because in an ideal situation, the parents would assume would be the ones who know best about that person. They've raised that person, they've raised their son or their daughter, so they're the ones who would know best the type of person that would suit their son or their daughter. But at the same time, what we should always realize, and this is where an extreme can come in, is that the role of the parents in that ideal situation is just to facilitate and help in choosing, to facilitate and to make easy the process of marriage for the man and the woman. But there is no absolute right that father and mother has in terms of making choice. There is no absolute right that the father or the mother has in terms of making the choice. And for the male, that's definite. There is no situation where the father, his word is absolutely binding upon his son. For the daughter, it's conditional. There's two conditions which we'll touch upon. But as long as those two conditions are fulfilled, then even in that situation, the daughter, as an edeb, as an etiquette, as a normal practice, as a traditional practice within society, she will go through her father and her mother. But that's just to facilitate, not that she must accept whatever is put in front of her. So the role of the father and mother is to help. The role of the father and mother is to help on the basis that they know what type of person you are and that they know what type of person suits you. But that isn't always the case. And often that's not the case. And in most cases that we're dealing with, on both sides, we're not dealing with ideals. On both sides, in terms of parents, we're not dealing with an ideal situation that the father and the mother are looking out for the best interest of the son or daughter. And also the son or the daughter are not necessarily respecting their parents, taking into consideration the advice of their parents. So we have some type of breakdown that starts happening. What we want to look upon here, bearing in mind, and it's important here, we don't want to go extremes. There should be no extremes in these matters. Bearing in mind that father and mother should be honoured as much as possible within the process. The father and the mother should be honoured. The father and mother should be respected. Their advice should be taken into consideration. But they do not have absolute authority in this matter. And from a religious perspective, in terms of hukum shara'i, in terms of legal ruling, parents do not have the absolute right of obedience. They do not have an absolute right to be obeyed. They have a conditional right to be obeyed. And we understand this from an ayah in the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَطِيعُ اللَّهُ وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولُ وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ. There's no absolute there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, obey Allah, that's absolute. There's never a situation where you can disobey Allah. Obey the messenger, that's absolute. There's never a situation where you can disobey the messenger and those in authority over you, which would include your parents, who have an authority over you. But here Allah subhanahu does not repeat the word obey. He does not repeat the word obey. He repeated it with the first two, obey Allah and obey the messenger. And then he didn't say and obey those with authority over you. He just said and those with authority over you, without repeating the word obey. And from that the scholars of the Quran understood that the right of those of authority over you is conditional upon that they obey Allah and the messenger. And their authority is tied into the authority of those who were mentioned before. Theirs is not absolute. But what is absolute in terms of your parents is respect for the parents. Even in a situation when your parents are telling you to do something which is wrong, or where they don't have the right, you still have no right to disrespect your parents. You have no right whatsoever to disrespect your parents. You're told, لا تقل لهما أف. Don't even say أف to them. Even if they're upsetting you, even if they're causing problems to you, even though you may disagree what they're saying, you cannot get angry with them. You cannot raise your voice against them. You cannot say anything that will upset them or hurt them. You just recognize the limits of the authority that they have, and you recognize the right that you have. So obedience to parents in this matter is ideal if they obey. If they're telling you to marry somebody who does haram and has no consideration of Allah and the Messenger, and you're trying to practice your deen, then you have no right to obey them. Instead, you should not obey them. And as we're going to read, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned in the hadith, whoever father marries off his daughter, Karima, his daughter, his precious one, to a fasiq, the father is the one who's broken family ties with him. The father is the one who's broken family ties. If he marries his daughter off to somebody who's fasiq, it's not that the daughter should accept and so on. If now she has to go along with it, he's the one who's zalim. The father is the one who's done wrong. He's the one who's qati ar-rahim, the one who cuts family ties, is cursed in the Quran. The Prophet ﷺ said he's the one who's caused that. He's the one who's done that. So there's no absolute obedience to the parents. There's respect. You should ideally consider. But then when parents have the idea that they have absolute rights to choose, then you fall into a problem. Like what? How would you deal with that situation? Where they're refusing your right to marry? Where they're refusing? And as we mentioned last time, the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ, he mentioned, and all parents should bear this in mind, because the warning from the Prophet ﷺ, he said, إِذَا جَاءَكُمْ مَنْ تَرْضَوْنَ دِينَهُ وَخُلُقَهُ فَزَوِّجُوهُ إِلَّا تَفْعَلُوهُ تَكُنْ فِتْنَةٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَفَسَادٌ كَبِيرٌ. If there comes to you, and this is speaking about your daughter, if there comes to you a man whose religion and his character you're happy with, and he's a man of deen, and he's a man of khuluq, he's a man of religion, and he's got good character, the Prophet, and he asks for your daughter's hand in marriage from you, فَزَوِّجُوا, marry your daughter off to him. If you do not do so, there will be fitna and fasad across the earth. And the fitna and the fasad is zina. The fitna and the fasad is zina. If you do not marry your daughter off, and if you start acting as a barrier, and you start stopping them, then they may well easily fall into haram because of you. And you have a significant element of their sin, because you're the one who pushed them down that path where they wanted to do halal, but you wouldn't allow them to do so. The Prophet ﷺ told you, as long as the person who comes and asks for your daughter's hand in marriage is a man of religion and is a man of good character, then you should not say no. You should accept. But parents have this idea that we can keep on refusing. Have this idea that they have an absolute authority in this matter. So then what we need to understand is the man is not obliged to, has no obligation to accept the refusal of his parents. He can marry without the permission of his parents. But that causes other problems which we'll speak about. The daughter, with certain conditions, two conditions, if her father, if she's not interested in marrying with somebody, his religion is good, his good character, it's confirmed, it's not just that she's fallen for him, she's besotted, but genuinely he's a good person for her, and her father and her mother refuses As long as two conditions are in place, she's entitled to marry. She's entitled to marry. Even if her father and mother are refusing, that's not considered disobedience of her towards her father and her mother. So now the social problem that's occurred, like for the next generation, those who have sons and daughters, when you're considering marrying off your sons and daughters, remember the advice of the Prophet ﷺ. As long as you're happy with that person's religion and his character, then marry your son or daughter off to them. You're not there to refuse, you're there just to make it as easy as possible for your son and daughter to marry a decent person. That's your responsibility. You do not have a God-given right just to keep on refusing just for the sake of it. Just for the sake of it. That's not your right. That's not, you don't have a right in this matter. In fact, you don't have a right. This is just about honouring the parents. It's about respecting the parents. And ideally, we want to honour, whatever possible, we want to respect and honour. But it's not about blocking and stopping your son and daughter from marrying. So where it becomes a problem, these are extreme statements. The parents, you must obey your parents because you are cursed if you don't. Paradise is under your mother's feet. We will never speak to you again. If you marry her, you are dead to us. You were promised to my brother's daughter when you were a child. You bring shame upon our name. I will pray against you and curse you, your name. And there's other threats that will come. There's other threats that will come. With all due respect and respect and honor for the parents have no right to do this. They have no right to do this. And it's your choice. If a person has parents who are causing difficulty and they're not facilitating, they're not making easy the process of marriage for them, they're putting unreasonable conditions, it's his choice if he wants to go along with it or not. He has the right to marry as a man, whoever he wants. As a woman, whoever she wants, with two conditions in place. Whoever she wants, with two conditions in place. If the parents start to dishonor and disrespect and start making unreasonable conditions and claims and statements, then still the ideal will be to try and find a compromise that will satisfy them, as well as matches your requirements that you're looking for. But if that doesn't happen, then you're entitled to marry. You're entitled to marry without permission of your parents. So all of this emotional blackmail that's used against people getting married, this doesn't hold. This doesn't hold. But at the same time, it depends upon that person whether how far he's willing to push it. Because it's all easy to say. It's easy to say, go and get married. But then there's practical issues around that. One is the issue about, usually often, your family will break ties from you. If a person's in that unfortunate situation, family will break ties from you. The other... It's a bit too loud. The other problem that would result... Is it okay? You happy with that? Okay. If you don't, you can go to the room. There's some gospel going on over there. You can go to that room. That's loud and clear. The other problem is that even if you are willing to go ahead to get married without permission of your parents, the probability is the other... Is it too echoey? Yeah. More important, where's my cup of tea? Where's my tea?
Where's your tea?
The other, in terms of practical issues, even if somebody is going to go ahead and get married, which he's entitled to, without permission of his family, then you have the problem with the permission of her family. Right? Because more often than not, in most cases, even if you want to get married, it's about honouring her family as well. And usually, in most cases, if you're willing to go yourself, most families will expect the family to be involved. So it's not that easy. It's not as simple as saying, my parents are refusing me, so I'll just go and get married anyway. In reality, it's not going to happen that way. So that's why, as much as is possible, a person should try and convince his parents, even if they're in the wrong, even if they cross the limits, as much as possible, try and convince that person's parents. Try and work on them, try and speak to them, try and make them understand and explain. There's many cultural barriers that prevent people from getting married. And not just cultural barriers from back home, even cultural barriers here. A cultural barrier here is the expectations about the age of a person. You're too young to get married. You're too young to get married. Even though the younger, the better. You don't have a job, you don't have a house, you don't have this, you don't have that. These are all cultural expectations, which all, they should not be factors in terms of marrying. In terms of getting married, if a person's able to get married, he should get married. So the parents are there to help. They are there to help. They're not there as barriers. They do not have a God-given right to impose whoever they want to marry. They are there to advise. They are there to suggest. They are there to see when someone has clearly not made the right choice, to advise them that that's not the right choice. I think we mentioned the hadith where a sahabiya, and particularly about women, where a sahabiya came to the Prophet ﷺ and mentioned that her father wanted her to marry her cousin. And the Prophet ﷺ told her to marry the cousin. But she said that there was nothing that she was particularly attracted to him. There was no particular reason for her to want to marry. And he said, don't marry. And the Prophet was easy about it. Either marry if you want to, if you don't want to, then don't marry. But this lady, the Sahabiya, she said, I have no issues marrying him. I have no issues marrying him. It's just that I want fathers to understand that they don't have the rights to choose for their daughters whoever they want. And the Prophet was silent, which means he agreed with her statements. And she came to show the ummah after that it's the person's choice. The parents are there just to help and to advise, but they have no absolute rights in this. A man has the right to choose whoever he wants to marry. And that's without any difference across this ummah. There's nobody who says other than that. There's nobody who says it other than that. Even if the father or the mother is saying no, you can't marry this person, you have an absolute right as a man or a woman to marry whoever you want. The woman, however, has a right. She also has a right with two conditions in place. And the conditions center around compatibility, what's known as kafa'a. Kafa'a in Sharia, and we're going to speak about that in a moment. But then the last point, marriage should not result in breaking families. Marriage is about extending the families, creating a new family out of two families. It's not about breaking up. It's not about breaking families that already exist. So where possible in the ideal situation, you want to do something that will satisfy your family, her family, and both of you, and then you can move forward with that. But at the same time, you have the right to refuse, and you have the right to choose. The issue now about permission with marriage. We've already mentioned bilijma, by consensus, the man does not need to ask anybody in terms of marriage. He does not need to ask, although it is adab, it is recommended, it is encouraged that you do everything through your family. That's encouraged. It's encouraged to do that. If you have agreement of your family from the very beginning, that's the perfect way of doing it. And as we'll discuss the process in terms of finding and in terms of contact and istikhara and all these issues, the earlier that you involve your family, the better it is. The earlier that you involve your family, the better that it is. And that's if somebody has a family who can help with these matters. So a man does not need permission. The woman does not need permission. And again, it's encouraged that she does have permission, as long as the man is compatible with her father or her guardian. And as we'll discuss this issue of compatibility, what we must bear in mind, the issue centers around father, not mother. Although in most families, it's mother, and father doesn't really say much. But in Sharia, it is father, not mother, who has, and some degree of authority in terms of marriage of his daughter. Also to add here, we're speaking from the Hanafi madhab. Here we're speaking from the Hanafi madhab. In the other three madhabs, a woman cannot marry without the permission of her father. A woman cannot marry without the permission of a father. In three madhabs, a woman cannot marry without permission of a father. And in three madhabs, the father can marry his daughter out without her permission. The father can marry his daughter off without her permission. The Hanafis alone state that one, nobody can marry an adult off, man and woman. Nobody can marry off without permission. Second, that she can marry without permission of her father as long as she meets the requirement of kafa'a, as long as she meets the requirement of compatibility. And then just to quickly run through what's compatibility. The first issue with compatibility, this is for a woman to marry. If he's a born Muslim and she is, she does not need permission. If he's a born Muslim and she's born into a family of Muslims, he does not need permission, or she does not need permission from her father to marry. If he's practicing, if he's a practicing Muslim and she is, and her family is, or her family isn't, then she doesn't need permission. As long as he's practicing, then she doesn't need permission of her father. If he's able to support her financially, and all four of these requirements must be met, all four of these requirements must be met. If he's able to pay, support her financially, which means two things. One, he's able to pay her dowry, and second, he's able to take care of her, support her. And I think in a couple of sessions we'll speak about that when we speak about responsibilities as a husband towards the wife. Amongst that is that he provides food and he provides shelter for her. These obligations upon the man, as long as he can support her financially, then she doesn't need permission. And then the last is that if he works in an occupation and a job that's considered equal or higher socially than her father's, she does not need permission. Where any of those are missing, she does need permission. She does need permission. If any of those four are missing, she will need permission. But as long as he's born Muslim, he's practicing Muslim, he's able to take care of her financially, and he has a job that's equal to, or socially is equal to, or higher status-wise than her father's, then she can marry without permission. But again, as we reiterate, we keep on saying, it is still recommended that it's done through the family. It is still recommended that it's done through the family. But in extreme cases, and unfortunately here in England, it's common. It's become more and more common where people are being prevented from getting married and they're meeting up and they're on the verge of falling into haram. Then these issues then come into play. These issues then come into play. Just to finish on the point of parents, ideally, and we want to emphasize this point because there's too much going away from this. You have two extremes where people who just get married not caring about their families, and on the other side, the families are coming to a point where they're stopping people from getting married, and they become a barrier for marriage. And the ideal is that you work through your family. The ideal is you work through your family from the very beginning, as soon as possible. And if your parents are not happy with who you're considering in marriage, and the reason why is valid, you can still marry, but still the ideal is you consider, particularly where they have a valid reason for why they're suggesting that you don't marry. And it's not like they say, no, we don't want you to get married, we just don't consider this person suitable. In a situation like that, the ideal is that you consider what your family say, your parents say, and try and go along with the advice of your parents. But if your parents are becoming unreasonable, for no reason they're refusing, then you do have the right to marry, even though your parents refuse, even though they know, and they may even be threatening you with breaking off ties and so on, although that's far from ideal. And if you can avoid that, you should avoid that at all costs. But you have the right. You have the right to marry, provided for the woman she fulfills and meets those requirements. we're going to then move on to look at, once you've found a person who fulfills the right qualities and your family is on board with you, and you're looking to go ahead with marriage, Once you know the qualities that are sought and that the Prophet advised, the next issue is how do you make the decision that this person is right or this person is not right? And once the decision is made, like, what happens after that? So there's a number of issues. One is how do you make the decision? How do you make the decision? Second is once the decision has been made, what is acceptable and what is not acceptable up until the point of the marriage? The first thing that you want to do, we have two things, al-istishara wal istikhara. Al-istishara wal istikhara. Al-istishara is taking advice from people. Al-istikhara is taking advice from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you want to do both. You want to do both. And al-istishara comes before al-istikhara. Al-istishara, asking advice from people, is the first thing. Because if there is clear reasons why you shouldn't marry that person, then you don't need to go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and ask. If it's obvious, then you don't need to go to, you can make a decision based upon what's clear in front of you. The problem, when you move away from family being involved, which is very normal now, is that your decision may well be clouded by your emotions. And often will be clouded by your emotions, in that a man and a woman will be attracted to each other, and they start realizing that they get on with each other, they're compatible with each other, compatible, not shar'i compatible, they feel that they get on with each other, to the point where when they're looking, they're blinded by their attachments, their emotions, and they're not looking clearly. Anybody looking from the outside can see that there's some real issues there. There's real problems. But when you tell him, he can't see it, and he won't listen to you. And when you tell her, she can't see it, and she won't listen, which is why the parents as a filter is very important. The parents, and if the parents are not there, then others around you, like other members of the family, friends who are close to you, they should be used as filters for you when you get too close, to stop you getting too close to somebody emotionally such that you're not so attached that you can't break away when you realize that it's wrong. And there's too much of that. Like brothers and sisters phoning up and say, can you do a nikah for us? Why? Like, why don't you go through your family? We're on the verge of doing haram. We're on the verge of doing haram. And these are not, people are not, these people are practicing. There's too much of it. Because why? Because of not using that safety net around you. The safety net of your family that's around you. And what happens there? You'll do the marriage just to avoid them doing haram. But at the same time, when you look at it, usually those type of marriages don't last very long. Usually those type of marriages do not last long. You'll do it to stop them doing haram. Well, 6 months later, a year later, they probably end up divorced. Why? Because the choice that they made was not based upon prophetic guidance, it was based upon their emotional attachments. It was based upon their emotional attachments. And that's why consultation is so important. That's why consultation is so important. Consult with people who know the person. I don't know if this is going to... Yeah, it's going to be mentioned. Consult with people who know the person. Try and find out about that person. The worst person to find out about that person is yourself. Directly from that person. What happens now? Couple want to get married, so they start going out with each other, justifying it, almost like dating, almost going out with each other, justifying it by saying that we need to know each other, get to know each other. The truth is, you spend time with each other, you never know each other. You never know each other. But if for example, the woman, the man, he asks his female family members, spend some time with her, and just see what she's like. Or, the man wants to get married to somebody who's related to you, female related to you. You as the father, you as the brother, you as the uncle, spend time with him. You'll find out a lot more in quick time than somebody trying to spend time with them, dating each other, going out with each other to try and get to know them. In reality, knowing nothing about them. What happens when two people start spending time with each other? They never show their true nature. You never see the true nature of each other, and you're not looking for problems, whereas your father's looking for problems, your mother's looking for issues. And that's what's needed here. It's what's needed here. You need to know that there are problems, significant issues. You need to know about that. You need to dig dirt out about people. You need to get to the bottom of what that person really like. Not when you sit there in front and he's smiling in front of you and she's smiling back at him and everything's wonderful. Everything's wonderful. And then a month into the marriage, it's not like what we thought. Your father sits with him. Your mother sits with her in quick time. That smile doesn't work to your father. That smile doesn't work with your mother. It works with each other. It doesn't work with your father or your mother. Straight away you'll realize whether this person's serious or not. Just the fact that he's willing to meet your father or your mother, or she's willing to meet the mother, indicates that there's seriousness there. Indicates that there's seriousness there. Like there are people who just want to spend time going out with each other, and then when you tell them, meet me family, you know you're getting a bit too serious. And that's come back, I've been told this. Like one brother said, I'm acting as a chaperone almost for my sister. So he said, what should I do? I said, any brother who wants to get in touch, who emails her directly, just tell her. Like, send it straight to the brother. Send it straight to the brother. The first time that happened, the first one, he says to her, you're getting a bit too serious for me. From the very beginning, you're too serious for me. But that tells you he wasn't serious about it himself. That tells you he just wanted a loose relationship with her. And then over time, if he's comfortable with her or not, then he will consider marriage. But that type of relation can never happen in Islam. It can never happen in Islam. Right? The process of looking for a partner does not allow you to commit haram. It does not allow you to break barriers. It does not allow the barriers of halal and haram to change just because you're considering, as we're going to see, when you're engaged, it does not change any hukum shar'i between you. It does not change any ruling between you. You're still prohibited for each other. You still do not have the right to spend time with each other. You still do not have any rights towards each other until the aqd takes place, until the contract. So in the process of looking, in the process of trying to decide, and once agreement to be made, you're still haram for each other. And no boundaries can come down. And it doesn't help in any way. In the process of deciding, it doesn't help. It's harmful. After agreement, it's harmful. It's harmful. Well, in the process before, it definitely doesn't help. So you want to consult and find out from those who know that person what type of person that is. Don't rely on your own judgment. Don't feel that you can get on with that person. That doesn't really mean anything before marriage. Remember the ayah that we mentioned at the beginning, the ayah about marriage. وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. That love and mercy doesn't come before. That's all pure lust and passion and haram. That's desire, nothing else. That doesn't tell you about whether you'll remain with each other. Even though you don't know each other. Even though you may feel that you don't get on with each other. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, He's the one who places love and mercy between you. So it doesn't really matter whether you feel you get on with each other or not. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to bring your hearts together. As long as you come into that marriage for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ensure that your hearts remain. But if you came into that marriage for other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there will be very little love and mercy between you. And that marriage becomes very difficult. So don't rely too much on your own judgment. Rely on the judgment of those who you trust and who you can ensure will come and make a right decision for you, give you right advice. Don't marry on the basis that you've fallen in love with her. This is the difficulty. This is the real difficulty. Right? When a brother and sister, they've been spending time with each other, they got to know each other at college or university or through work. They spent a lot of time with each other. And you advise them that you really need to know more about each other. You really need to know more about each other. Find out from somebody who knows each other better. But now that love and that attachment has taken place. The difficulty with that is, one, if that marriage is not going to happen, that attachment in the heart will always be there. Thank you. That attachment in the heart will always be there. And the worst case scenario, a person gets married to another person and he has feelings to another woman or another man. Because of that, the ideal is that should never happen. That should never happen. You shouldn't have been engaged in a relationship where when you do finally get married to somebody else, you've got emotions and feelings for another person. For another person. That should not happen. But when it comes to that situation, and you tell them that you shouldn't really marry just based on the fact that you've fallen for each other, you should marry on the basis that there are certain qualities that are good within each other for you to be a husband, for you to be a wife, for you to be a father for your children, for her to be a mother to your children. The real qualities that matter, they're the real things that should be looked at. But when you advise them, it's just like the attachment is too strong and I can't separate from her and I can't leave her and I can't break away from her. At that point, it becomes very difficult. And again, that marriage, even though it may well go ahead, there's potentially a lot of problems with that marriage. A lot of problems may occur with that marriage. Love marriage, arranged marriages that are done. And in Islam, we don't say forced marriages. But arranged marriages where there's a system, that's what Islam is about. But love marriage, where somebody falls for a person, that's likely to fail. That's likely to fail. So don't marry on the basis that you fall in love with her. Remember that love develops within marriage because that's something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places within the marriage. And particularly before marriage, particularly when a person's young, once a person's been married for 5, for 10, 15 years, the nature of the love changes from being something that's physical. At the beginning, there's a physical love that's there. But somebody's like been married 10, 15, 20 years, there's a companionship that's developed. There's a companionship that's developed. Like that person, he's been there for her, he's been there, he's taken care of her. For 10, 15, 20 years, he's been working, he's been supporting, he's looked after her, he's raised her children with him, and she's done the same, she's been taking care of him. She's raised his children whilst he's out working, she's looking after his family. Like, there's bound to be a bond and a love that develops because of it, which is beyond the physical. Which is beyond the physical. That's something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places between the two. So that type of love will develop in a marriage that's done for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If your advice is asked, you must be truthful. You must be truthful. And you are allowed to backbite. If somebody comes to you and asks you advice, المستشار مؤتمن. The Prophet ﷺ said, the person whose advice is sought has an amana, he has a trust. If somebody in any sphere of life, if somebody comes and asks you for the advice, there's an amana within that. There's a trust that you must hold. He's come to you believing that you will be truthful in advice. And that's why, from the secret of advice, only go to those whose advice you trust. Don't go to random people. Only go to people who can give you sincere advice. And there's a lot of people who have hasad towards other people. They have hasad towards other people. They have envy. And there's people who carry ill thoughts. Only, like personal matters, only go to people that you know will give you real advice. Only go to people, and particularly in a matter as central within your life as marriage, only go to somebody who you trust will give you sincere advice. And that person, when he gives you advice, or when you ask for advice about what type of person that is, you must be truthful in the advice that you give. You must mention certain things that other people wouldn't know about. If you know that person has bad qualities, always full of rage and anger, which wouldn't be known otherwise, but he's come and asked you, always getting angry, that's one of the dangerous things to have in a relationship. Being married to somebody who's always angry and can't control his anger, that's where violence comes into relationships. And you want somebody who's going to respect you and who's going to show tolerance and overlook your faults. But if somebody is always angry, and you know, as a person who's been advised, you know that that person's always angry, then you need to mention that to that person. You need to mention that to that person. If you know that person's tight with money, and he's not going to spend upon his wife and his family in a proper manner, and you know that about that person, then you'll have to speak the truth about that person. You have to speak the truth about that person. You know there's some problems in his family that may well affect his marriage. You know that there's certain issues around the family that may cause problems within that marriage, and you've been asked, you must speak the truth. This is one of the cases where you're allowed to backbite. And it is backbiting, but there's no sin in this backbiting, because the Prophet ﷺ, when he was asked by a Sahabiya, a companion came to him, a female companion came to him ﷺ, and asked advice about a Sahabi, or two companions had proposed to the same woman. She comes to the Prophet ﷺ and he says, this one, and he's tight with his money, that one, he never places his staff down from his neck. One of the meanings of that is that he's violent. The Prophet ﷺ said, don't marry this one, don't marry that one. The Prophet ﷺ spoke about those negative qualities within. And although that's backbiting, because you reveal something, it's related to the need of the moment. You have to speak. If you now say, knowing that there's a problem, knowing, and more so with the woman, perhaps less with the man, even though it's still an imana, because a man can divorce, whereas the woman cannot divorce. The man can divorce. If the man's made a mistake, the man can easily come out of the marriage. For the woman, it's a lot more difficult to come out of the marriage. It's very difficult for a woman to come out of the marriage. So the woman's process of coming to a decision is a lot more important than the man's. So if she realizes, or if you know, that that person's proposed to her, there's problems, but he's your mate, you still have to speak. Even though he's a friend of yours, you still have to speak that there's problems with this person. And it's a wajib upon you to do. It's an obligation upon you to do. And if you don't do that, you've betrayed the trust of that person. So be truthful and backbite if needed. But principle in Sharia, al-daruratu tuqaddaru biqadariha. Only speak about what's needed. Don't go beyond that. That does not give you a license to say whatever you like about that person. That's not a moment where you can just get everything off your chest now about that person. Only speak about what's related to the issue at hand. The moment you step beyond, you fall into the sin of backbiting. You fall into the haram of backbiting. The other issue when considering, if someone has had a past and been engaged in haram relationships before, but now has changed, and that's history, that's past, that person is not required to reveal. That person is not required to reveal at that moment. If that's in the past, not if it's ongoing, if that person still has certain qualities, still in a relationship, for example, that has to be mentioned. Some cases where the parents want them to get married, where he's going out with some girl and marry this good Muslim girl, and your advice has been sought, then you let them know. Because there are marriages that are messed up because he's still going out with somebody and his family wanted him to marry a good practicing woman who would take care of them at home, which is a khiyana, which is a betrayal to that woman, to the woman that he married. And if you're aware of that, then you have to speak. It's a fard upon you to speak. If there's some deceit within the process, it's fard upon you to speak. But if there's a past that he's broken away from and he has nothing more to do with, or she has nothing more to do with, then that's in the past. There's no obligation to reveal it. Even if he asks, then you use, you don't lie. You don't lie, but you use tawriya. You make a statement that's not lying, but misleading. You don't lie. You don't outright lie. But tawriya is something that's confirmed as being an acceptable practice, where you say something where you mean something else, but the person understands a different thing in response. Like Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he smashed the idols, he says, fa'alahu kabiruhum. He points at the idol. And he says, fa'alahu kabiruhum. And this is how, according to Imam Fakhruddin al-Razi, that's how he pointed. He pointed with his thumb, and he said, the big one did it. They all understand he means the idol, but he's looking at his thumb as he's saying it. So he's giving one statement, they understand another. You're allowed to do that. That's in the Quran. فَعَلَهُ كَبِيرُهُمْ هَذَا. And the big one did it, as he looks at his thumb, and they're looking at the idol. The big one did it. That's called tawriya, where you give a false impression of what you mean. That's better than exposing haram that you engage in, that you've broken away from, and you've made complete tawbah from. So if somebody does have a past where they've engaged in haram, do not reveal it. Do not reveal it. Unless that person asks directly, where you cannot lie, but tawriyah is a better option. So do as much istishara as is required. Consult, ask, find out details to know about what that person's really about. Don't rely upon your own judgment. You're the worst person to decide about whether she's good for you to marry. Then follow the sunnah of the Prophet. See, this one in most cases now doesn't really apply, because in most cases they've been going out with each other. Often people have been going out. Well, let's assume, ideally halal, you're doing it in a halal manner, you're doing it in a lawful manner, you want to do everything according to the sunnah and not fall into haram, so there's barakah in your marriage, so that Allah will place more mercy and more love between you. So you're trying your best to do everything in a lawful manner. Then at least once meet. Meet each other to see if there's physical attraction. And that's the sunnah that the Prophet ﷺ stated, which tells us, when he ﷺ said that some people marry because of luck, some people because of family, and some people because of wealth, he said marry because of religion, he wasn't saying don't marry because of looks and because of how you feel attracted. He's not saying don't do it because of that. He's saying make religion your primary. Once religion is confirmed and character is confirmed, then you should still also confirm that you are attracted to each other physically. That you're attracted to each other physically. That's what the Prophet ﷺ told the Sahabi who'd married. He said, why didn't you see her? Why didn't you go and see what she looked like? And the same for her. So meet each other at least once. This meeting is not about spending time to get to know each other, because people now go to that meeting with a list of questions. Want to interrogate each other. That's not what the Prophet ﷺ said that meeting was for. Ideally, you should have done that already. You should have found out enough about that person already that you're willing to go ahead and consider. This is not about, I've got loads of questions for you and you can ask your questions to me now. Although, and some of my teachers, when I asked them this, they said that's not what it's for. Some of them said it's become an urf now, it's become a norm, so it can be accepted. But some of my teachers, they said, that's not what the Prophet was saying to do. He said, look at each other. That was particularly about confirming whether you're physically attracted to each other. So meet each other to see if there's physical attraction. And that's the only purpose, that's the only real purpose of that meeting, assuming that you've not met each other. But don't use it as an excuse to start spending time with each other, to start going out with each other. In none of this process, none of this process allows you to do haram. This is perhaps the only occasion where you cannot do haram, but where, and here when you're looking at each other, even if you find physical, if you look at the face of a woman and you find physical attraction, it's haram for you to look. You must lower your gaze. You must lower your gaze. It's haram for you to look if you find attraction. This is one of the cases where they said, even if you find attraction, it's still okay for you to look. It's still okay for you to look, and it's sunnah for you to look, even if you find attraction, because that's the reason why you're there, to confirm that you are attracted to each other. So this is one of the exceptions. As a norm, if you find that by looking the face of a woman it's affecting you, then it's haram for you to look, and you've been ordered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ, tell the believing men to lower their gaze, وَيَحْفَظُوا فُرُوجَهُمْ, and protect their chastity. But in this case, look, even if you find attraction, with the niyyah, I'm doing it to fulfill the sunnah. I'm doing it to fulfill the sunnah that the Prophet ﷺ instructed. But not to go beyond that. Along with that, you've fulfilled the process of istishara. You've consulted, you've tried to find out. You've met in a lawful situation, not being alone. Not being alone. Best thing, the ideal way of doing it, if you're doing it through family, is that it's done through the families. It's arranged, and it's arranged through the families. That's the best way. That's the best way of doing it. But it doesn't have to be in that setting. As long as it's public and it's not, there's no khalwa that takes place. There's no khalwa. There's no seclusion that takes place. As long as you're not private, alone with her, then the meeting can take place in any setting. But then, after that, or along with that, the whole of this process, ensure that you pray Salat al-Istikhara. Ensure that you pray Salat al-Istikhara. After you've consulted people, you've consulted your family, you've consulted people who know her, you've met the person to see whether you're happy or not, turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't rely solely upon human beings. But istikhara is a prayer of guidance, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guidance when you're not certain about a matter. Even if you are certain, there's still no harm in praying istikhara. But particularly when you're not certain about a matter, when you're unsure about a matter, when you may have some doubt in your mind about a matter, it's more important that you pray Salat al-Istikhara. Al-Istikhara means seeking a choice from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to choose for you and to show you and guide you to what's best for you. Pray Salat al-Istikhara. Preferably do for 7 days. Preferably do for seven days. Istikhara, just a slight tangent. It's not a prayer only for marriage. It's only ever done by people for marriage. But the Prophet Sayyidina Jabir ibn Abdullah, we mentioned the prayer of istikhara, he said the Prophet taught us, whenever we need to make a decision for anything, to do istikhara. Anything in your life that you need to make a decision on. If you're thinking about going into a new job, pray istikhara. If you're thinking about moving home, pray istikhara. If you're thinking about going on a journey, pray istikhara. Pray istikhara. Keep on, just get into the habit, pray istikhara. Whenever you can do that, whenever you need to do that, pray istikhara. Even some of the books relating to the adab of studying, they say whenever you're thinking of joining a class or studying with a teacher, pray istikhara. Pray istikhara. Any decision that you need to make, pray Salat al-Istikhara. And they will only be good. They will only be good that will come out of istikhara. La khaba man istikhara. The one who does istikhara will never be ruined. The one who doesn't will fail on a lot of occasions. And even though, bear in mind with istikhara, that you may have many cases where the decision is not what you necessarily wanted, but it will always be good. It will always be good. عَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. Perhaps you don't like something, but it's good for you. Perhaps you like something and it's not good for you. وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Allah knows, you don't know. And that's the essence of istikhara. Allah knows, you don't know. So you go to the one who knows to give you a sign, to open up for you a way when you're uncertain about what's the best thing to do. So pray istikhara. Preferably do 7 days. Ideally, best thing with istikhara, do fresh wudu. Pray 2 raka'ah nafl. Pray 2 raka'ah nafl. With niyat al-istikhara. With the intention of istikhara. After you finish your istikhara, then read the dua. And as with all du'as, begin with praise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and send prayers upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then read this specific dua. Allahumma inni istakhiruka bi'ilmika wa astaqdiruka biqudratika wa as'aluka min fadlika al-azim fa'innaka taqdiru wa la aqdir wa ta'lamu wa la a'lam wa anta allamul ghuyub. Allahumma in kunta ta'lamu anna hadha al-amr, anna hadha al-amr, anna hadha al-zawaj. Mention what it is. All of you know that this matter, mention what the matter is. Anna hadha al-zawaj. خَيْرٌ لِي فِي دِينِ وَمَعَاشِ وَعَاقِبَةِ أَمْرِي وَعَاجِنِهِ وَآجِنِهِ فَاقْدُرْهُ لِي وَيَسِّرْهُ لِي ثُمَّ بَارِكْ لِي فِيهِ. وَإِن كُنْتَ تَعْلَمُ أَنَّ هَذَا الزَّوَاجِ شَرٌ لِي فِي دِينِ وَمَعَاشِ وَعَاقِبَةِ أَمْرِي وَعَاجِنِهِ وَآجِنِهِ فَاصْرِفْهُ عَنِّي وَاصْرِفْنِي عَنْهُ وَاقْدُرْ لِي الْخَيْرَ حَيْثُ كَانَ ثُمَّ رَضِّنِي بِهِ. And then end with salawat upon the Prophet. Always begin your dua with salawat. Ideally, in the middle of your dua, salawat, and end with salawat, and Allah subhanahu will not refuse that dua. If you have in the beginning, the middle, and the end of a dua, prayers upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it will never be refused, it will always be answered. The dua, O Allah, I ask you to show me what is best through your knowledge, and bring it to pass through your knowledge, and I ask you of your immense favour, for you are all powerful, and I am not. You know, and I do not, and you are the knower of the unseen. O Allah, if you know this matter, and mention the matter, mention the matter. You could read the dua in English if you're not memorized it. You could read the dua in English. So you say, oh, if you know that this marriage to be better for me, my religion, livelihood, final outcome, and the short and long term of my case, then bring it about and facilitate it for me and bless me with abundance therein. And if you know this matter, this marriage to be worse for me, my religion, livelihood, final outcome, and the short and long term of my case, then keep it from me and keep me from it and bring about the good for me, whatever it may be, and make me pleased with it. Make me pleased with whatever you decide for me. وَرَضِّنِي بِهِ, make me happy with whatever your qada is on this matter. So after you pray the istikhara, what is it that you're looking for? Two things. A feeling in your heart. Dreams may also come, but that supports the feeling in your heart. The most important thing you're looking for is a feeling in your heart. You may pray istikhara, you may be uncertain about it, and you wake up and then some sign comes your way, or in your heart you suddenly feel comfortable about the idea. The other key thing, you suddenly find openings. It suddenly becomes very easy for you. There were certain barriers, there were certain hurdles. You prayed istikhara, you've asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide. Through that guidance, He's opened up and He's made it easy for you. Suddenly, your father who wasn't happy with it is now okay with it. Her family who wasn't agreeing with it, suddenly become okay with it as a result of your istikhara. As a result of your istikhara. And if you realize that your family is causing difficulties, you're having problems, pray istikhara. And if it's meant to be, it will come to pass. However difficult your family are being, if it's meant to be, either Allah will turn their hearts to it, or it will make it easy for you, even though they may not accept it or they may not be happy with it. So pray istikhara and seek out signs, feelings, signs, and also openings that come your way. If you find after your istikhara that it's still difficult, that in your heart you still have some, it's still not totally clear and it's difficult, do it for 7 days. At the end of 7 days, nothing happens, nothing clear, it's still very difficult, then leave it. The sign there is to indicate that it wasn't meant to be. If it was meant to be, you would have had a clear sign in your heart or outwardly, and it would have opened up for you. Tawali al-umur. Suddenly things would become easier for you. This ayah sums up both points. Al-istishara wa al-istikhara, which both essential in the process of marriage. This ayah sums up both. And this is general. This ayah took place, was revealed at the Ghazwa of Uhud, when the Prophet ﷺ was discussing about them, whether they should stay in Medina and defend from Medina, or should they go out and fight out. This ayah was revealed, وَشَاوِرْهُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ, consult with them in the matter, in any matter, consult with people. The Prophet ﷺ would consult all the time, even though he was getting direct guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was setting us the sunnah of consult whenever you need to make a decision. Turn to people who have got more understanding than you whenever you need to make a decision. فَإِذَا عَزَمْتَ فَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ. But once you've made a decision, then rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Once you've turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you've turned to people, you've turned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the path in front of you is clear, then do not have any doubts about it. Just go with whatever is meant to happen. And here the key thing in marriage, in the process of marriage, is not just to keep on delaying and I'm not sure. And if you've done istishara and istikhara and you're still not sure, then leave it. If you've consulted people and consulted Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you're still not sure, then it's telling you it's not meant to be. Because the process should have come taken to a conclusion. But once you're sure about a matter, tawakkal ala Allah. Then just leave it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just go along with it, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will facilitate. And however difficult it may be seen, وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. One of the amazing ayahs about taqwa. Whoever has taqwa Allah ta'ala, whoever has fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, يَجْعَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا, He will give him a way out of anything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make a path for you in anything that you do, as long as you have that connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He will give you مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. As long as you maintain that firm connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even though you're looking, you keep on looking to get married, and you keep on coming, you're complaining, I'm not finding, it's hard. Just keep that taqwa Allah ta'ala. Just hold firm to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Never lose that connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even if it comes to a point where you're like, I've tried everything and I still can't. That's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who's deciding for you that it's not meant to be up until that point. So as long as you maintain that hold with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will always give you a makhraj. He will always give you a way. And He'll provide for you min haythu la yahtasib, from places that you could never imagine. There's you thinking that this wife and that wife, all the people that you potentially could know, and then suddenly somebody comes along and suggests you this person that you had never crossed your mind. Min haythu la yahtasib, from a place that you could never have imagined. As long as you hold firm to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will always give you a way and will provide for you from places that you could never imagine. So hold on to istishara. Do istishara, do istikhara, and then tawakkal ala Allah. Do both and then rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and be radi with whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants for you. Just be happy with whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants for you, because that's the end of your dua of istikhara. Wa raddini bih. Make me happy with whatever your decision is. Make me happy with whatever your decision is. The last point there about istikhara, there's no guarantees of success. You may have done your istishara, you may have done your istikhara, but then brothers and sisters come and say, then how come they got divorced afterwards? If they did the istishara and the istikhara, they consulted people and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how come they got divorced afterwards? If they consulted Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they consulted people and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it was meant to be, it's khair, it's good for them. But that's not to say forever that they will live happily ever after. That's not a guarantee that. It may well be that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted them for that period of time. And it was good, as long as they did istikhara and istishara. As long as they consulted people and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even though in the future it may not turn out to remain that way. But for as long as it happened, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted that to happen. And He was content with that to happen. And it's not, we're going to speak about in a future session, I think the last session, when we speak about how to cope with breakdowns within marriages. Although divorce is the last thing you want to consider, especially when you get married, it shouldn't really be on your mind, the idea that you may divorce. But there's no guarantees for success in anything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has opened the path for you. As far as you're concerned, that's your partner in this world and in the next world. That's the commitment to marriage, this world and next world. You're with that person. Right, Amjid? Alhamdulillah. But if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decides that it's not going to remain, then that's the decision of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and be content with it. And be content with it. Once you've decided, you've come to a decision, you may, now what's normal is to have an engagement. To have an engagement. Up until the point where you've made the definite decision that you're going to get married, up until that point where you're consulting and you're trying to find out stuff about that person, you haven't made any decision. Neither of you have any commitment towards the other. And shara'an, although people, they don't like this idea, but in sharia, you can consider more than one proposal at the same time. You can consider more than one. Because we know that sahabiyah who came to the Prophet had been proposed to by two people. He received proposal. Although, practically, a person may feel that I only want to consider one, and then once this, if I decide not, then I will consider another person. But a person is perfectly entitled, shara'an, legally, to consider as many proposals as they want, up until the point of engagement. Up until the point of agreement. At that point, the woman should not consider any other proposal from that point. The man can, because he's got three more that he can do. Right, Muhammad? He can consider another three. But the woman, she's not allowed. It's makruh, tahreem. The Hanafi is makruh, tahreem. The Jumhur, it's haram. Once she's agreed, she's committed to marry somebody. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, that a man should not propose over the proposal of his brother. And he should not undercut the proposal of his brother. Meaning, once a person has proposed and they've agreed, it is prohibited then to propose to that woman. You should not override his proposal, and then unless they break their proposal at that point. But from the point of proposal up until the point of marriage, the two of them are committed. The Prophet ﷺ forbade another person proposing at that point. So the woman should not consider any other proposals from this point onwards. Before that she can, and he can. It is prohibited. The Hanafis makruh tahrim, the Jumhur, the majority is haram for a man to propose to a woman who is engaged. Up until this point, just a side point. There is no harm in having engagement parties. There are some ulama who say it's a practice of the kuffar and it came in from the unbelievers and so on. Which is true, but there's no harm in it. Because as long as you don't consider it to be prophetic in nature. But one thing we find as a general practice, the Prophet would celebrate when there's happy news or a happy occasion. So it doesn't contradict the essential principle of Islam. Like when a child is born, what do you do? Aqiqah. Why is that sunnah? To celebrate the birth of a child. To celebrate the birth of a child. And you have celebrating Eid. Celebration of events is an accepted practice within Islam. The Prophet ﷺ said he fasted on Monday because I was born on it. So because of that connection to his birth, he celebrated by fasting. The Prophet ﷺ, Eid, why? Because we're more worthy of celebrating the salvation. Or Yom Ashura, fasting the Monday, the 10th of Muharram, because of the salvation of Musa ﷺ and Bani Israel from the Jews. These are all acts of celebration. So when there's an engagement that's taking place, there's no harm in having a celebration for that. We don't believe that the Prophet ﷺ did it. But it doesn't go against any principles in our religion. And the general principle of practice, at-tarku la yadullu ala tahrim. The fact that the Prophet ﷺ didn't do something doesn't mean make it haram for you to do it. At-tarku la yadullu ala tahrim. The fact that he didn't do it does not mean it's haram for you. It just means, or it's only when it contradicts a principle or a prohibition in Islam, then it becomes haram for you. Because the Prophet ﷺ, he said, وَمَا نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْهُ فَاجْتَنِبُوا. So whatever I forbade you from doing, avoid that. He did not say, وَمَا تَرَكْتُمُوهُ or وَمَا تَرَكْتُهُ فَاجْتَنِبُوا. Whatever I didn't do, avoid it. He didn't say that. He said, whatever I forbade you from doing, he said, avoid it. So there's no harm in having an engagement party at this point. Then, the man and woman are still not married. Everything that's haram remains haram. And perhaps it's more important at this point. Are they allowed to spend time with each other? No. Are they allowed to spend time with each other on the phone? Like even some people say, now that we've been engaged, our parents are okay with it. They don't mind spending a lot of time together on the phone. No. The same prohibitions remain. She's haram for you up until the point of aqd. He's haram for you up until the point of marriage. And the problem here is because people feel that soon after we'll get married, it's a lot more easy to slip into haram. Knowing that if haram took place, we're getting married anyway. Whereas before the engagement, the agreement, there was no certainty about that. But once everybody's agreed and it's going on, it's so much more easy to slip into haram. So there's more of a reason. Ideally, if you're going to do ideal, and this almost seems like unheard of here, but this is where we should aspire to in marriage. The only time you should have met the person you get married is at that time when you wanted to see her to fulfill the sunnah. Ideally, it's the only time that the two of you met. And that's what will place the greatest barakah within your marriage. That's what will place the process all the way up until marriage does not allow you to do haram. Does not allow you to get to know each other, to spend time with each other. All that will take place once a person's married And if a person's done all of that haram, it may well have a negative impact upon their marriage. If they've done haram of that nature, they should try and make some tawbah for that, so it doesn't impact upon their marriage. Because at the very beginning, even pre-marriage, there's been certain acts that they've done that may well impact upon their marriage. So that's important to note. Can you exchange phones? Can you spend time, phone numbers? Can you spend time with each other now that you're engaged? Can you communicate, correspond with each other by email? And so all that, you should view her as any other female that is haram for you. It's only at the point of the aqad, the marriage contract, that it's allowed. It is better to marry sooner rather than later. It is better to marry sooner rather than later. And wherever it's possible, once you've agreed, and again, your family is usually the problem with this. Because the moment the agreement comes out, all the family members have got to check their diaries. When are we all free? And it's usually, there's marriage season usually around the summer when everybody's free. It shouldn't happen that way. Although, yes, you want as many people to be present, and you want as many people to come and celebrate with you the happy occasion. But it shouldn't be a cause that everybody can come, but the sister can't come, so we've got to delay for another month for the sister. It shouldn't work that way. The sooner the better. As soon as possible as you can arrange it. As soon as possible you can arrange it. And that's the best type of marriage that there is. There's no reason to drag it out. There's no reason to extend it. The idea of a year later, 2 years later, you've got to know each other. You want to get married. Your parents come and say, after you finish your degree, after you've got a job. All of that shouldn't really be happening. At the very least, this practice happens in some Arab countries. In Egypt it happens. In Sham it happens. In Syria it happens. And it's a very good practice. And maybe it should be introduced here as well. Where the aqad will take place, but they don't actually live together for over a year. Where the contract takes place. The marriage contract takes place. But for a year they remain as they are. As they are. Just gives them time to get to know each other. In a completely lawful manner, and then after a year, they will do a formal walima, and they'll come together, and they'll live together. In a case where a marriage formally can't take place for a while, then with pressure upon family, do the aqd straight away, do the contract straight away, and then delay the actual living together for a period of time. There's absolutely no harm with doing that, because it makes the contact completely lawful between the two of them. It's better to have marriage sooner rather than later. Try not to delay. The more you delay, the more likely haram will happen. The more you delay, the more likely haram will happen. The more the delays, the less blessings there are within that marriage. Just to finish off this point, we're going to touch upon one or two simple points about marriage contract itself, and then we'll begin speaking about response. Next, in our next session, I don't think it's in January, it's in February, isn't it? I don't think, is it February, yeah? Yeah. We're going to speak about, I think it's the husband's responsibilities towards the wife. The husband, so all the husbands need to come for that one, but make sure the wives don't come. So they don't know. But we will touch upon one or two points around the marriage contract itself, just to have some clarity on that. Just a couple of statements to finish off all the discussion about pre-marriage. This is from Ihya ul-Muddin. Al-Ghazali rahimahullah says, whoever marries his daughter to an unjust man, a sinner, a deviant, it's makruh tahreem to marry, it's sinful to marry a deviant. As someone whose belief is outside of Ahl Sunnah, a person should not marry that person. Same as marrying, or it's worse than marrying a fasiq. It's worse than marrying a sinner. A deviant or an alcoholic has committed a crime against his religion and has exposed himself to divine wrath. Because he has broken his family ties and has made a bad choice. And so that father who's committed to marrying off his daughter to his sister's son, for example, his nephew, not caring about whether he worships or not, not caring about whether he commits haram, Al-Ghazali said he's committed a crime against his deen. He's exposed himself to the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he's the one who's broken his family ties. And he's the one who's made a bad choice. So instead of blaming the daughter's refusing or the son who's refusing, maybe we should focus the intention on the father who's making the bad choice. Because too often, you'll be told you should be obedient to your parents. You should listen to your parents. If they're making a choice of this nature, the parents should be advised. bearing in mind what we said about choice, they don't have the right to make this decision. But always keep in mind that that haram choice, they're doing haram, and obedience to Allah and His Messenger requires that you don't obey your parents when they're making a haram choice. That you don't obey your parents when they're making a haram choice. A man said to Hassan al-Basri, a number of men have asked for my daughter, who should I marry her to? He said, the one who fears Allah. If he loves her, in ahabbaha akramaha, wa in karihaha lam yadhlimha. If he loves her, he will honor her. And if he dislikes her, he will not wrong her. He will not wrong her. If he dislikes her, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us an order in the Quran, which we're going to speak about in our next session. فَإِمْسَاكُمْ بِمَعْرُوفٍ أَوْ تَسْرِيحٌ بِإِحْسَانٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says with marriage, says keep your wife with you in a good manner. I live with her and treat her in a good manner, or release her from the marriage in a good manner. But to wrong her, many will just out of badness within them, vengeful nature, like they realize the marriage, but I won't divorce her, I want to make her suffer. And there are people, unfortunately, will do that. There are people, unfortunately, will do that. Family will not allow him to divorce her, even though there's no marriage going on there. They won't allow him to divorce her. Imam Hassan al-Basri gives you the key points. If he's a man of religion, if he can't make it work, then he's not going to make her suffer. He's not going to make her suffer. But if the marriage is fine, he's going to treat her, he's going to honor her, he's going to respect her in the best of manner. So bear those two statements in mind, the statements of Al-Ghazali and the statements of Imam Hassan al-Basri. And then the hadith, the last one to mention, the Prophet ﷺ says, whoever marries his daughter, and here he used the word karimatahu, karima, and his honor, to a sinner, has broken ties with her. And the one who breaks ties is cursed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran. وَتَقَطَّعُوا أَرْحَامَهُمْ أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ لَعَنَهُمُ اللَّهِ. And they break family ties, those are the ones whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has cursed. The father who forces his daughter into marriage with a fasiq is under the curse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of the act that he's done. Wallahu a'lam. So we'll speak about some issues around the marriage, and then we'll go on to the man's responsibility towards the wife. We'll do that in our next session next month. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen.